everybody. Welcome back. This is India Airbook session. Lot of bad news, lot of deaths around. I hope all of you are taking great care of yourself. Tough times for the world, tough times for everybody. It calls for a lot of patience, lot of perseverance. Well, the learning never stops. Exam is ahead. So let's continue. Today's session will be an important session. This is India Airbook session. From last two sessions, I wanted to cover the idea of states and union territories. So in session 4, I have exclusively dedicated so that I will be able to cover states and union territories. Friends, mind you, exam has a syllabus which is geography, history, polity and economics, and this will be asked in varied domains. Keeping that in consideration, India Airbook gives you a critical edge. It is dependent on how do we take that in perspective. So, in today's session, we will be doing states and union territories. I will be trying to cover at least 4 states by which you will be able to understand how you go about. I will also tell you how you will be taking it ahead so that you can cover them by yourself for the remaining states. Okay, let's go ahead. So, India Airbook session 2020. So, this is the India Airbook 2020. We have already done 3 sessions. This is the 4th session. In the first 3 sessions, we have done with regular topics. Today, we will take a specific topic of India Airbook. In the India Airbook, we will be covering the states and union territories, and there specifically we will be concentrating on the states of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, considering they will be giving you a lot of information also. So let's go in. So coming back to the contents page of the India Airbook, in the contents page, as we discussed on the first session, we have multiple ideas taking into consideration, and the last topic of which is very important is states and union territories. So we are dealing specifically with states and union territories today, and as I have marked out here, states and union territories part, if you understand how it is to be read, you will be getting questions from geography, polity, history, economics, every aspect of UPSC. Now, when I say history, art and culture questions specifically, many times those data, that information which you will not find anywhere, you will be able to find in this part of it. So, let's get it. States and union territories. So, this is the 30th topic with the states and union territories. I will start with the first state, Andhra Pradesh. I will do the Andhra Pradesh state a little in detail so that you understand how you need to do states and union territories. But before we start, friends, don't try to do all states and union territories in a single day or in a single session. I would request, as you plan to study your India book, per day, gather about 2 chapters if they are small chapters, or 1 chapter if it's a big chapter. Along with that, do 2 states per day. So plan your session in such a manner that you will be able to do 2 states and 1 chapter. If they are small chapters, 2 chapters and 2 states. Okay. So don't do all these states together. Do 2 states at once. Okay, when you are doing these states, you need not remember every single information. You will have to capture the information. Now, how do we capture the information from exam relevance? That is something that we will be discussing now. Okay, so let's start with the state of Andhra Pradesh. Whenever you are doing your states, always keep your atlas next to you. How will you use the atlas? I will explain that, but let's get to the information that is available. Okay. Basics, let us keep it clear. You will not try to remember every single thing. Okay. Now, the reason why I picked up Andhra Pradesh is because it's a recently formed state or a recently reorganized state. So, there can be questions expected depending on the history, geography or the polity also. Okay. So, right away. Andhra Pradesh area, you need not remember the number, but I'll tell you how that becomes important. Capital. Okay, there is recent controversy in terms of the capital of Andhra Pradesh because the new government, which is the YS Jagan Mohan Reddy's government, has decided that they will have about 3 capitals to the state. But as of now, the decided capital is Amaravati. They are still to take a final call. Okay. So there will be no question on that. But you should know Amaravati is a very important place when it comes to Buddhist architecture. Okay. So if there is Mathura architecture and the Gandhara architecture in terms of Buddhists, down south you have the Amaravati style of architecture, which is also from Buddhas. Considering ahead, look at this. For every state you do, consider the principal languages. You need not by heart because you will largely be able to guess. But look at this. Andhra Pradesh, we largely know, is a Telugu speaking state. But look at the principal languages of Andhra Pradesh. Telugu, we all know that. Urdu, the second most important language in Andhra Pradesh is Urdu. Right, so please understand, Urdu is a very important language when it comes to Andhra Pradesh. Ruled by the former Nizams, and Urdu has a significance. Apart from that is Hindi. Telugu, Urdu, Hindi, and next is Banjara. Now, this is where a question can arise. How can a question arise here? A question can arise here taking into consideration the specificity of how a topic arises. Now, Banjara is also a tribe. So, there can be a question which talks about which is a state which has a population of considerable population of Banjaras. So, that is Andhra Pradesh. Similarly, Banjara is a language, right? So, it's a nomadic tribe in a sense. So, in that idea, Banjara becomes a principal language of Andhra Pradesh. So, one glance of this, you will know Telugu, Urdu, Hindi and Banjara are principal languages of Andhra Pradesh. Going ahead. The earliest mention of Andhras is said to be in Aitreya Brahmana, right? Now, generally when you take any state, the first two paragraphs, you will get the history and geography of that state. So, this paragraph deals with the history and this paragraph deals with the geography of the state. So, the first idea, you see, the earliest mention of Andhras is said to be in Aitreya Brahmana. So, if there can be a question that which of the state are we speaking about with the following features, and if they give you 4 statements, of which this can be one statement, you should be able to identify. Okay. So, first mention is Aitreya Brahmana. It indicates Andhras originally an Aryan race. Now, understand. Andhra Pradesh is a Telugu-speaking South Indian state, which means largely South India is associated with the Dravidian style. So, the Dravidian race is limited to Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and Kerala. Andhras are originally Aryan in race. Okay. So, on that sense, you will not completely consider Andhras as Dravidian in culture and Dravidian in race. Okay, so Andhras originally Aryan, they migrated south of India, later mixed with non-Aryans. This is how the idea comes about. So the regular history. So entire first paragraph gives you complete idea of the history as such. So please read that. Again, what will you remember? You will remember these aspects like what we have marked out. Okay, during the following centuries, like Satavahanas, Sakas, Ikshvakus, Eastern Chalukyas, Kakatiyas. These are some of the dynasties that they have ruled. A mere identification would do. You need not by heart. Okay. So, Satavahanas ruled almost 300 years. They are unsung heroes of South Indian history. So, in that sense, Satavahanas, Sakas, Ikshvakus, Eastern Chalukyas, Kakatiyas have their land in the Telugu country. Further, we also see the Vijayanagara kingdom, Qutub Shahis, and the Nizams. Qutub Shahis are the Bahmanis, Vijayanagara kingdom and the Nizams. This is how the history has followed till independence. Right. After independence, we see Telugu speaking areas were separated from the composite Madras presidency. We all know that there was a huge struggle going on for linguistic reorganization of state. And the first state to have been separated on language basis was Andhra. Potti Sriramulu's fast, we all know, and that is how this aspect comes together. So, in that sense, we know new Andhra state came about in 1st October 1953, separated from Madras presidency. Later, with the State Reorganization Act being passed in 1956, the Hyderabad state and the Andhra state both were merged and consequently came about Andhra Pradesh in 1st November 1956, which is history. Now, this Hyderabad state and Andhra state were merged, which very recently were separated, and we know that today we have two separate states. One is Telangana and other one is Andhra Pradesh. So, this is a very brief history of Andhra Pradesh, right? So, you have to remember only few ideas here, and these few ideas will help you answer questions. So, it's all about targeting based on questions, okay? Going ahead. Andhra Pradesh is situated, this is now the geography part of it, okay? So, Andhra Pradesh is situated on the country's southeastern coast. So, we all know Andhra Pradesh comes to the eastern coast and the southeastern coast. That is the first idea. It is the 8th largest state in the country. So, you need not remember this area, but if you remember it is the 8th largest state, you will be able to identify. Next. According to 2011 census, the state is the 10th largest by population. So, 8th largest by area and 10th largest by population. This number is enough. These numbers of the square kilometers or the crores in terms of population is not required. The state has the second longest coastline. Now again, 974 kilometers you need not remember, but it has the second largest coastline. So who has the largest coastline? Second only to Gujarat. So Gujarat has the longest coastline in India. India being a peninsular country, Gujarat has the longest coastline and the second longest coastline is Andhra Pradesh. This is something that you have to understand. This borders, which means Andhra Pradesh borders with all states. There have been questions in the past in UPSC which has asked you about how many states have bordered, because there is a small confusion. For example, how many of us understand Andhra Pradesh borders Chhattisgarh or not? Now, the previous Andhra Pradesh, which was the combined Andhra Pradesh, which included Telangana, did border Chhattisgarh. But after separation, does it border? Such kind of questions. So, the India Yearbook gives you a clarification. It borders Telangana, then it borders Chhattisgarh. So, it is clarifying Andhra Pradesh is bordering Chhattisgarh. So, Telangana, Chhattisgarh, Odisha, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, and the water body of Bay of Bengal in the east. So, these are the states. So, Telangana, Chhattisgarh, Odisha, Karnataka, and Tamil Nadu are the bordering states of Andhra Pradesh. Very clearly, a small enclave of the district of Puducherry, right? So, we all understand Puducherry is a union territory. And most of us may be in the normal assumption that Puducherry is only that Pondicherry part which is inside Tamil Nadu. But understand, Puducherry has four different ideas. It is Puducherry, it is Yanam, it is Karaikal and Mahe. Of which Yanam comes in Andhra Pradesh region. Puducherry and Karaikal are in Tamil Nadu. Mahe is in Kerala. So there is a part of Puducherry to the Arabian Sea also. So this idea of mapping is something that you will be able to get through mapping as such. Okay. So as you see here, the first paragraph gives you the history, the second paragraph gives you the geography, and brief information which you will be able to collect, it is very significant. Okay. Now let's just take you to the map. I'll take you to the map which you will be doing through your atlas. Okay. I'll not do it very detailed, just so that how you'll be able to compare that with respect to the map. Okay, the history and geography part we have taken, we will take you to the map now. Coming to the map specifically, do you see here that this is the new map of the reorganized state of Andhra Pradesh? Andhra Pradesh initially included this idea of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. So, this entire part was Andhra Pradesh. After the reorganization, this is Telangana, which has Hyderabad as its capital. Andhra Pradesh is the remaining part, right? So, we generally divide this as Telangana, this as the Simandra region, and this as the Rayalaseema region. So this is the basic idea of India's political map where you have to know. Right. So clearly giving you a picture, you see this Puducherry, this is the Union Territory. Puducherry has Karaikal, which is in Tamil Nadu here. So Puducherry and Karaikal within Tamil Nadu. Yanam here in Andhra Pradesh is part of Puducherry. Similarly, Mahe here in Kerala is also part of Puducherry. Okay. So Puducherry is 1, 2, 3 Yanam and 4 Mahe. Okay. So that is something that you should know. And as you saw, the states that are surrounding Karnataka, Telangana, Odisha and Chhattisgarh. Okay. So Andhra Pradesh does not border Maharashtra. It borders Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Telangana, Chhattisgarh and Odisha. The earlier Andhra Pradesh was bordering Maharashtra because Telangana was part. Now that Telangana is not part, Telangana is a separate state, Andhra Pradesh does not border Maharashtra. That is something that you should be taking into consideration going ahead. This is how the separation comes about. You see the separation? This is the Rayalaseema region. This is the Telangana region, which is now separated. And this in yellow is your coastal Andhra or the Simandhra region. Right. So this is the Rayalaseema region. This is the Telangana region. And this is the coastal Andhra, which is the Simandhra region. So the yellow and the saffron here, this comes about to be the Andhra Pradesh. And this in lavender is largely Telangana region. That is how the separation comes about. Okay. So this is how the separation is. This is largely including districts. You need not remember the districts. This is where a geographical phenomenon comes about, the Eastern Godavari region, where you see there's an estuary that gets formed here. Okay. We all know the eastern coast of India is very famous for its deltas. Okay. So the Godavari delta is a very famous delta. Going ahead, again the political map of Andhra Pradesh specifically, this is the new map of Andhra Pradesh. This is where the new capital was supposed to be, Amaravati. But now there are new decisions to be taken. They are planning for three different capitals for regional balance. And they also want to ensure that there is further movement in terms. So that is still a clarity to be arrived. Otherwise, what you should note here in this region is the presence of important regions like Vishakhapatnam. Vishakhapatnam is a major port. India has about 13 major ports, of which Vishakhapatnam is one major port here, Vishakhapatnam. Okay. So Andhra Pradesh major port is Vishakhapatnam. There's another port called Machilipatnam. Machilipatnam is a minor port, and Machilipatnam is important from history's perspective also because the British had settlements in this region. Okay, so Machilipatnam region. Similarly, coming now in this region, you see Chittor, right? So Chittor, Anandpur, all these are regions famous for their own set. Guntur. Guntur is famous for chilies. Prakasham district is famous. Again, Ongole region is very famous for this because Ongole has a breed of cow. Ongole breed of cow. Okay. So these are things that you'll have to do from mapping perspective, from the geography idea of mapping. This is the human geography part of mapping. Rajamundry region, Krishna district, the Kalamkari art that comes out when it comes to is in the same Krishna region, the Krishna river flows through in the same idea. Godavari river you see here, Krishna river you see here, then the Krishna delta here, this is the Godavari delta here, right? And this is how the entire Andhra Pradesh comes about. Okay, so this is the basic map that you should know, right? And then if you see the larger sense of the ports that you see here, you see that Vishakhapatnam is a major port. Apart from that, within Andhra Pradesh you see Kakinada and Machilipatnam are also ports. I will draw your interest to one other port, which is Krishnapatnam. Krishnapatnam is a major port, but it is not a public sector port. It is a private sector port. Krishnapatnam is a private sector port. India's only large private sector port, a large port, is Krishnapatnam. It's a major port, but a private sector port. Right? Vishakhapatnam is a major port, but it's a public sector port. Krishnapatnam is a private sector port. This is the basic geography that we should know. Okay. Coming back to the yearbook now, in terms of the information, we have done the history and geography. Going ahead, we will see there is polity of Andhra Pradesh. Andhra Pradesh Reorganization Act. Andhra Pradesh Reorganization Act of 2014, commonly called the Telangana Act. Why? Because the Reorganization Act formed the new state of Telangana. Okay, so this was passed in 2014. Bifurcation of Andhra Pradesh into two states of Telangana and the residuary Andhra Pradesh. The act consists of division of assets, liabilities, finalizing the boundaries, proposed new states and status of Hyderabad. This is about the reorganization of the Andhra Pradesh State Act. Then come to agriculture. So very quickly, agriculture is the main occupation. Up to about 62% of the people are largely dependent on agriculture. Rice is a major food crop contributing to almost 77% of the food grain population. Andhra Pradesh is huge producer of rice. Other major crops that are coming out are jowar, bajra, maize, ragi. Right, so jowar, bajra, maize, ragi, small millets, pulses, castor, which is the oilseed, castor, tobacco. So, Andhra Pradesh has the coastal side, Andhra Pradesh has the interior, which is a little semi-arid also. So, all kinds of growth happens here. So, jowar, bajra, maize, ragi, small millets, pulses, castor, tobacco, cotton, sugarcane, all these are part of agriculture. Forest cover is about 23%. So, there are important forest products like teak, eucalyptus, cashew, casuarina, bamboo and softwood. Red sandal is a recent controversy. If you remember, red sandal was also from Andhra Pradesh. Okay, so this is in terms of agriculture. Going into irrigation, numerous projects have been taken up under Jalayagnam program. So, there can be a simple question. Jalayagnam program is about which state? Okay. Why? Project Bhagirathi was also there, which is Telangana. Jalayagnam program is Andhra Pradesh. The program aims to complete the ongoing and new projects in a record time, provide immediate irrigation and top priority to mobilizing funds for all possible sources. Next, taking into power. Power, you see that important power projects which are hydroelectric projects, thermal power projects. Now here you have to be little careful because they have not updated Nagarjun Sagar, yes, Neelam Sanjeev Reddy Sagar, yes, these are all hydroelectric projects, also known as the Sri Sailam project. Upper Sileru, Lower Sileru, Tungabhadra, these are all based on river. Sileru is a river, Tungabhadra is a river, right? So Upper Sileru, Lower Sileru, Tungabhadra projects, all these are hydroelectric power projects. Now, when you come to Ramagundam, Kotagundam, Vijayawada, Mudanur, these are Tamil projects. Vijayawada, Mudanur are Tamil power projects within Andhra Pradesh, but Ramagundam and Kotagundam are part of Telangana. These are coal-rich areas. These come to the Godavari Rift Valley. Ramagundam and Kotagundam are part of Telangana, but these are thermal power projects. Okay, so you should be able to separate, distinguish between thermal power projects and the hydroelectric power projects. Okay, so Ramagundam and Kotagundam are part of Telangana. Okay, coming down to industries now. The state government is extending various incentives to small scale industries, tiny sector, and by which there are special economic zones. So, general information, mines and geology. Look at the information here. So, we are talking about mines and geology. In mines and geology, look at the first statement. Andhra Pradesh is globally known for variety of rocks and minerals, and it is regarded as what? It is regarded as the Ratnagarbha. So, it is Andhra Pradesh which is regarded as the Ratnagarbha. The state has the largest deposits of quality chrysolite asbestos. So, largest deposit of asbestos is in Andhra Pradesh. Other important minerals that are present are copper, manganese, mica, coal, because the Godavari Rift Valley, and limestone. These are the other important. Which are the coal mines? Singareni coal mines. Singareni coal mines are part of Andhra Pradesh. Right. Like I said, Adilabad, Ramagundam, Kotagundam are part of Telangana. Singareni coal mines are part of Andhra Pradesh. So, these are in terms of mines and minerals. Ratnagarbha. largest deposits of asbestos. Apart from that, copper ore, manganese, mica, coal, limestone are all major minerals present here. Okay, so more than 100 to 110 million tons of industrial minerals, 200 million cubic meters of stone, building material. Andhra Pradesh stands first in barites and limestone production in the country. So it stands first in barites and limestone production in the country. This is something that you should know. Okay. There is always a tussle between Bangalore and Hyderabad in terms of information technology. Andhra Pradesh has been forging ahead in the sphere of IT, information technology. The state has introduced many schemes in utilizing maximum number of human resources in terms of IT sector. Coming to transport. Transport again gets divided into roads, railways and ports. The road network is almost about some 1,000 kilometers. You need not remember that. But you should know that there is widespread road connectivity, the railway connectivity, aviation also. Okay, so there is aviation. Important airports are the Shamshabad Airport, Tirupati Airport, Vishakhapatnam Airport. International flights are operated from Shamshabad Airport. There is the Hyderabad Airport, which is known as the Rajiv Gandhi International Airport. So these are important airports. So there is very good air connectivity also. When it comes to ports, one of the major port is at Vishakhapatnam. We have already seen that in the map. This is Vishakhapatnam. Right, there are about 13 non-major ports, which is the minor ports. So one major port is Vishakhapatnam, 13 non-major ports, which are minor ports. And as we have already said, Krishnapatnam port is a major port, but it's a private sector port. Ports offer tremendous potential for growth and widespread. So in terms of international shipping, coastal shipping, shipping repairs, fishing, captive ports, all these, all weather port tourism, everything is facilitated. So Andhra Pradesh has the benefit of being a coastal state, that too on the east coast. Okay. Yes, it has its own negatives. Why? Because it's one of the most rabid state when it comes to tropical cyclones. Going ahead, tourist centers. Andhra Pradesh Tourism Development Corporation continues to strive. There are multiple tourism, ecotourism, beach tourism, right, and cruise tourism. So all three types of tourism when it comes to. And then the corporation currently runs a chain of 52 hotels. Tourism Development Corporation runs 52 hotels, more than so many rooms, bus, impressive fleet of buses, which are some of the important tourist spots, right? Now look at that, Char Minar, right? Salarjung Museum, Charminar, Salarjung Museum, Golconda Fort in Hyderabad. Now, this all were part of the integrated Andhra Pradesh, presently part of Telangana, because this is in Hyderabad. Charminar, Salarjung, Golconda Fort are all part of Hyderabad, which is part of Telangana. Thousand Pillar Temple Fort in Varangal, Sri Lakshmi Narasimha Swami Temple at Yadagiri Gutta, Buddhist Stupa at Nagarjunakonda, Nagarjuna Sagar, Sri Venkateshwara Temple, Tirumala Tirupati. Now, this is the second richest religious temple in the world after Vatican. This is the second richest in terms of the donations that it receives. This is part of Andhra Pradesh. Mallikarjuna Swami Temple, Kanakadurga Temple of Vijayawada, Satyanarayana Swami Temple, Varaha Narasimha Swami Temple, Simachalam, Sitarama Temple, Bhadrachalam, Arakku Valley, Horsley Hills, Horsley Hills, Neelapattu. Neelapattu is a bird sanctuary. Okay, so Neelapattu is a bird sanctuary. So these are some things which are given here. Okay, now the last part as we go about is the government. You need not remember the governor, you need not remember the chief minister, because it is subject to change. Jurisdiction of the High Court. Now, till recently, both of them had a same High Court. Very recently, they have separated. So Andhra Pradesh has a separate High Court in terms of Andhra Pradesh. Okay, so this is Andhra Pradesh as a state that we have done. Okay, quickly going back in terms of what we have done, see, right, so this is where we started. The first important thing we noted was about Banjara tribe, then going in the Aitreya Brahmana, where the earliest mention, Andhras of the Aryan race, so they are mix of Aryan and non-Aryans, the kingdoms that they have ruled, Vijayanagara, Kutub Shahis of the Bahamanis and the Nizams, after independence, the new Andhra state in 1953, and in 1956, the formation of the combined Andhra state, which is including Telangana, which later got separated. Geography, southeastern coast, 8th largest state by area, 10th largest by population, 2nd longest coastline, highest is Gujarat, and the states that it border. Yanam is a small district enclave, which is there, of Puducherry, which is in Andhra Pradesh. We have seen the map. Then going ahead, the Reorganization Act, we understood where there was separation of Telangana. Agriculture, we saw a rise for the highest. Apart from that, Jowar, Bajra, maize, ragi, pulses, castor, tobacco, cotton, sugarcane, all these are grown. There are some forest products also that come out. Irrigation, Jalayagnam program is important. The hydroelectric power projects, thermal power projects, we have seen. Mines and geology, we know it is known as the Ratnagarbha, largest deposits of quality chrysolite, asbestos. So Ratnagarbha, largest deposit of asbestos, stands first in barites and limestone production. Apart from that, copper ore, manganese, mica, coal, limestone, Singareni coal mine. So this is information. If you are able to go through the map and if you are able to mark specifically, you will be done. This is how you should do. Okay, so taking into transport, there are roads, railways, aviation, ports, you know, Visakhapatnam, 13 major ports coming into consideration. Tourist centers, ecotourism, beach tourism, cruise tourism, these were part of Telangana. And taking ahead, these are religious tourism, which they have mentioned here and taking specifically, right? The Horsley Hills, Neelapattu is a bird sanctuary, okay? And the jurisdiction of the High Court is Andhra Pradesh. So for every state, do this much. Principal languages at the start, jurisdiction of the High Court at the end, and the history, geography, and the regions ahead. Okay. So this is how you do Andhra Pradesh. Okay. Now that we have done Andhra Pradesh, with this, we will also do Telangana. Okay. So let's move to Telangana. Here we come to Telangana. Telangana is after reorganization. So, as we said, for every state, don't worry about the amount in terms of India. Capital is Hyderabad, we know. Population is this. Principal languages. Now, there were principal languages, which was Telugu, Urdu, Hindi and Banjara. In Telangana, principal languages is Telugu and Urdu. So, two important languages, Telugu and Urdu. 2014, Telangana was formed as the 29th state of India. Okay. So, do we have 29 states today? 2014, yes, we had the 29 state, but recently with reorganization of Jammu and Kashmir, India is back to 28 states. Okay. Why? Because Jammu and Kashmir, which was a state, is now two union territories. So Telangana was the 29th state, but today India has only 28 states. Okay. Hyderabad is the capital. Earlier, Telangana was part of Andhra Pradesh. We know as per the Linguistic Reorganization Act of 1956, Telangana has about 10 districts. You need not remember all, but have a familiarity. Hyderabad, Adilabad, Khammam, Karimnagar, Mehboobnagar, Medak, Nalgonda, Nizamabad, Rangareddy, Warangal are all part of Telangana. Okay, so these are 10 districts. History of Telangana. Now, there needs to be some history why there was a lot of fight for separation. The name Telangana. Now, there, the earliest mention of Andhra Pradesh was Aitreya Brahmana. The name Telangana here refers to the word Trilinga Desha. Okay. So, Trilinga Desha earned due to the presence of the ancient Shiva temples. So, name Telangana, word Trilinga Desha, ancient Shiva temples. Where are the Shiva temples? Kaleshwaram, Sri Shaidam, and Drakasramam. Kaleshwaram, Sri Sailam, and Drakasramam, these are the three ancient Shiva temples together known as the Trilinga Desha, which today comes to be known as the Telangana. A major historical reason is that during the reign of Nizams, known as the Telugu Angana. So, Telugu Angana, which came to be known as Telangana. Okay. Again, who are the great dynasties who have ruled here? So here also you see there are Satavahanas, there are Kakatiyas, Chalukyas, Mughals, Qutub Shahis, Asaf Jahis. Then Asaf Jahis are Nizams. Okay. So Satavahanas, Kakatiyas, Chalukyas, Mughals, Qutub Shahis are Bahamanis, Asaf Jahis are Nizams. Kakatiyas' contribution to architecture is considered very impressive. Apart from among the Kakatiyas, Prataparudra was the greatest ruler. Okay, so just a familiarity as such, Prataparudra. You need not remember the years when he ruled. Okay, the Satavahanas ruled Telangana for almost 400 years. from 2 century BC to the 2nd century AD. Then there have been several movements to revoke the merger of Telangana. So that movement went on 1969-72, 2009 movements went on. Finally, the 2009 movement got much more importance. Violent protests led by the people of coastal Andhra, Rayalaseema region occurred, and finally you had the separation. July 2013, the bill was passed after various stages. So you had the Andhra Pradesh Reorganization Bill that was passed in the parliament in 2014. Okay, so 2014 Andhra Pradesh Reorganization Bill passed. This is how the separation comes. So we know the history of Telangana in terms of the formation as such. Now let's get to the geography of Telangana. It is situated in the Deccan Plateau. Okay, so it is part of the Deccan Plateau, central stretch. Now Telangana, mind you, is an interior state, which means it's a landlocked state. Okay, it's a landlocked state. It doesn't have any coast. It's situated in Deccan Plateau, eastern seaboard of Indian Peninsula. It covers almost 11,400 square kilometers, not required, drained by two major rivers. So there are two major rivers which are draining, with about 79% of Godavari's catchment area and 69% of Krishna River. So again, two rivers, which is Godavari and Krishna. Okay, taking the specific consideration. Right, so land is arid. Now, most of the land is arid. It is a landlocked state. One of the major reasons why there was struggle, because it was a neglected part. The Adilabad, Nizamabad, Karimnagar, right, Ramagundam, Kotagadam region is largely arid. Most of the land is arid. And arid due to higher elevation, most of the state compared to rivers. So, the higher elevation is mostly arid. Telangana is drained mainly by several minor rivers, such as Bhima. There is Bhima, there is Manjira, there is Musi. Bhima, Manjira, Musi are all tributaries of Krishna. The state is surrounded by, Maharashtra, then Karnataka, Chhattisgarh, Odisha. Okay. So apart from Andhra Pradesh, which we know, you have Maharashtra, Karnataka, Chhattisgarh and Odisha. Okay, so these are the states which are surrounding. You should know this. So, history and geography done. Go back to the map. Thoroughly do the map. You'll be able to understand. Okay, very quickly. Let me take you to the map. If I'm taking you to the map, here you see Telangana is this part. So, Telangana is Karnataka, Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh. So, Odisha, we largely don't feel this part, but the yearbook says it does. Other than this, Andhra Pradesh. So, Telangana has nothing to do with Goa, Telangana has nothing to do with Tamil Nadu, Telangana has nothing to do with Puducherry's any part. Okay? So, this is where your Telangana is. Taking further ahead, this part of the 10 districts are Telangana. Adilabad, Nizamabad, Karimnagar, Medak, Warangal, Khammam, Nagamunda, Rangareddy, Mehboob Nagar, all these are part of. And this is where the white region that you see here is Hyderabad that comes about. Okay? So, this is Hyderabad. Taking in specifically, this part is Telangana. Okay, so that's how you will have to largely understand from the mapping perspective. Now getting back to specific. History and geography done. Agriculture, rice again is a major food crop of the state. Other important is it has tropical fruits, mango, right? It has semi-arid regions, so there is tobacco cultivation, there is cotton cultivation, and a part also of sugarcane cultivation. Major kharif crop are coarse cereals. So coarse cereals, maize, jowar, bajra, ragi are also produced in the state. So ragi, bajra, maize, jowar are also produced. Right? Out of the entire area, the 23.9% which is forest, 10.5% and fallow lands, normal agriculture purpose, barren also. Net cropped area is so much hectares. Agriculture depends on distribution of rainfall. The predominant influence of southwest monsoon. This is where we are looking at. Okay. Agriculture. Arts and crafts. Handicrafts have been an integral part of the state. So, handicrafts is an integral part of the state. Okay. Which are these handicrafts? Let's understand. The region offers astounding handicrafts like the bidri crafts. Okay. So, bidri craft. Banjara needle crafts. Dokra metal crafts. So, bidri. Banjara needle crafts. Dokra metal crafts. Nirmal arts. Bronze castings, lacquer ware. Now, these are something that you should be able to identify. Art and culture questions can arise from here. be it the intricate needlecraft, bronze casting, everything comes from Telangana. So Bidri, Banjara needlecraft, Dokra metalcraft, Nirmal Arts, bronze casting. Okay. Continuing with art and culture, look at the festivals. Batukamma, a very beautiful festival. It's a very colorful festival, and festival of flower stands that they make. Okay, so as that's given also here, it's a festival of flower stands. Batukamma is a festival of flower stands, is a symbol of cultural identity. Apart from Batukamma, Bonalu. Bonalu is an annual Hindu festival celebrated with respect to goddess Mahakali. It's worship. Okay, so Batukamma and Bonalu. Now, Dasara we'll be able to identify, but Batukamma and Bonalu are festivals specific to Telangana. Okay, beautiful festivals. Dasara, Samakka Saraka Jatra, Pirala Panduga, Ramzan are largely celebrated. So these are the other festivals which you should be able to identify, but Batukamma and Bonalu are specific to Telangana. Okay, this is in terms of Telangana. Last part that you see in terms of Telangana here is you have a separate governor, chief minister, chief secretary. The jurisdiction of High Court is Telangana, which is the Hyderabad High Court itself. Okay. So Telangana jurisdiction is Telangana High Court. This is how you do a state. Okay. So the idea was to give you how to be specific, and we've given you understanding. We've done two states, which is Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. Okay, we will do two other states, and there we will specifically take two northeastern states. The two northeastern states I would wish to take here because northeast is a very favorite area of UPSC. So considering that, we will take two northeastern states. We have done Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. We will do Assam and Arunachal Pradesh. Okay, so we'll take in Assam and Arunachal Pradesh now. Okay, so as we said, we have done Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. Now let's do Arunachal Pradesh. Let me repeat, northeastern states are a favorite area of UPSC. Favorite because they come under Schedule 6 and Schedule 5 region also. They are also important because a lot of art and culture, lot of tribe related questions arise from here. Okay, so we start with Arunachal Pradesh. As we said, whenever you start, look at the area, very small state, capital. Okay, try to know all the capitals of northeastern state. Arunachal Pradesh capital is Itanagar. Okay, principal languages. Now, very important, note these principal languages. I'll tell you why. Nishi, Adi, Bengali, Nepali, Hindi, Mompa, Assamese, Vanchu, Tansa, Mishmi, Mishing, Nokpe, etc. When you see this, do I need to remember all these? You need not by heart, but 90% of these are also names of the tribes. Okay, so there are immense number of times where questions have come based on tribes of the states, and these are questions also based on the languages. Okay, so Nishi is a tribe, Adi is a tribe, Mohpa is a tribe, Wangchu, Tangsa, Mishmi, Mishing, Nokte, these are all names of tribes, and these are also principal languages. So knowing this, you should be able to identify this. These tribes come from this state also. Okay, so that is why this is very important. So this part you should be able to identify. Nishi, Adi, Mohpa, Assamese, Nepali, Hindi, Wangchu, Tangsa, Mishmi, Mishing, Nokte, etc. So let's get into the history and geography. Arunachal Pradesh, we should know, earlier was known as the Northeast Frontier Agency. Right? Arunachal Pradesh was not a full-fledged state to start with. It became a full-fledged state in 1987. You need not remember date and etc. But as part of polity, when you are studying how the union and territory was formed, you will be able to know. So till 1972, it was known as the Northeast Frontier Agency. It gained a union territory status, so it became a union territory first in 1972, renamed as Arunachal Pradesh. On 15th August 1975, it had an elected legislative assembly and a vast council of ministers assumed. First general election happened in 1978. Administratively, state was divided into 16 districts. 16 districts, mind you. Okay, 16 districts. Capital of the state is Itanagar in Papumpeh district. So a name, Papumpeh district. Where does the idea of Papumpeh comes? Arunachal Pradesh. Itanagar is named after the Ita fort. So Ita fort comes Itanagar. Ita meaning fort of bricks. Eat. In Hindi, eet is bricks. So, Eta Fort meaning the fort of bricks built in the 14th century. So, look at the history. It became a full-fledged state in 87. Till 72, it was known as the Northeast Frontier Agency. In 72, it got the Union Territory status, renamed as Arunachal Pradesh. 75, it got an elected legislative assembly. And then 78, it was divided into 16 districts. The capital is Itanagar, Papumpeh district. Itanagar name is from Eta Fort, which is the fort of bricks. Arunachal Pradesh finds its mention in the literature. Now, Arunachal Pradesh finds its mention in the literature Kalika Purana. Okay, you remember? There was Aitreya Brahmana for Andhra Pradesh. There was Trilinga Desha of the three Shiva temples for Telangana. There is Kalika Purana and Mahabharata. So, Arunachal Pradesh. How do you remember? How do you understand? Arunachal Pradesh finds mention in literature of Kalika Purana and Mahabharata. This place is the Prabhu Mountains of Puranas. So, the Prabhu Mountains of Puranas comes around. So, Arunachal Pradesh largely considered a tribal state. We will not be able to link Mahabharata and Kalika Purana and others. But Kalika Purana and Mahabharata have mention of Arunachal Pradesh, the Prabhu Mountains. Okay. So, this is the history. The widely scattered archaeological remains at different places in Arunachal Pradesh bear testimony to its rich cultural heritage. Please do the map of Arunachal Pradesh. In fact, the entire Indian state map you should do. Oxford School Atlas. Right? Oxford Student Atlas. I'm sorry, Oxford Student Atlas. Not the school atlas, student atlas. The best atlas to do. Indian mapping, every state specifically, and most importantly, northeastern states. You have to do that. Okay? Right. So, please do the map of the entire India, specifically northeastern states. They are very important. Okay. Taking into consideration now. Go ahead. Consider the geography part of it. Arunachal Pradesh, if we look at India in Arunachal Pradesh, is very much specifically in the northeastern region. Arunachal Pradesh is that transition region between the temperate climate and the tropical climate. So, you will see Arunachal Pradesh has horticulture which has temperate fruits and tropical fruits also. So, it's a very interesting state. You should do the map. Agriculture and horticulture when you look at it. Agriculture is the mainstay of the people living in the state. Mainly depend on jhum cultivation. What is jhum? Jhum cultivation, as we know, is shifting cultivation. Okay, so the tribals there follow jhum cultivation or shifting cultivation. Encouragement is also being given for the cultivation of cash crops like potatoes, horticulture crops like apples, oranges and pineapples. Okay, industries and minerals for conservation exploration. Arunachal Pradesh Mineral Development Trading Corporation has been set up. Now get to the festivals. Okay, a tribal state, northeastern states, very important from art and culture perspective. Questions can definitely come. Look at the important festivals. Important festivals of the state are Mupin. Okay, so they can just be a matni following. Mupin, Sulung. And Mupin and Sulung is celebrated by whom? By the Adis. Adis are tribes. They are celebrating the festival Mupin and Sulung. Okay. Then you have Losar. Losar festival of Monpas. Monpas is the tribe. Losar is the festival. Losar of Monpas. Similarly, Buriboot. Buriboot of the Hill Miris. Okay. If you know the Arunachal Pradesh, there are four hills which are taken into consideration, which is the Dafla, Miri, Abor, Mishmi. Now, Dafla, Miri, Abor, Mishmi are hills in terms of their ranges. The names are also based on the tribes. So, Dafla, Miri, Abor, Mishmi are based on the tribes also. That's where you see here. Mupin and Sulung are festivals of the Adis. Losar festival of Monpas. Buriboot of Hill Miris. Hill Miris are the tribes. Sherdukpens, Dri of the Apatanis. Now, Apatani is a tribe. Sherdukpen and Dri are festivals. Singdoi of the Tagins, Re of the Idumishmis, Nyokhom of Nishis. Animal sacrifice is a common ritual among most of these festivals. So you see here, this one paragraph gives you so much of information on festivals and also tribes. Right. So if you're able to just map them apart and if you're able to remember them, you can answer questions. So this is where you get a gold mine of information. Festivals, art and culture related. Going ahead, tourist centers. Places of tourist interest are Tawang, Buddhist monastery in Tawang, Dirang. Tawang you will be able to identify, but Dirang is also Arunachal Pradesh. Bumdila. So Tawang, Dirang, Bumdila, Tipi, Itanagar, the capital, Maliditan, Likhabali, Pasighat, Along, Tezu, Miao, Ripong, Najila, Namdapa, Bisham Nagar, Parshuram Kund, Konsa. All these are part of Arunachal Pradesh, a beautiful tourist place. And these are all the tourist centers. Now, these can be part as questions. There can be statements, there can be a map the following, there can be correctly matched statements. You should be able to identify. And Namdapa is also a wildlife reserve. Namdapa is that wildlife reserve which has both tropical and temperate characteristics present. Okay, so this is how you should be able to identify. This is Arunachal Pradesh for you. Finally, the government there. Right, Chief Minister, Governor, Chief Secretary, you need not remember. There was a lot of controversy in the way government was formed and how it was reformed. There was a lot of anti-defection that happened. And on that sense, you should know, otherwise not required. Jurisdiction. Now look at the jurisdiction here. Northeastern states have specific. Arunachal Pradesh does not have a high court of its own. It comes under the jurisdiction of the Guwahati High Court. So Guwahati is Assam and Arunachal Pradesh falls under Guwahati High Court. So this is also a question probably. This is how you should be able to do. Okay. So on one side, the main states of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana we did when you got information in general. We are doing northeastern states where we first did Arunachal Pradesh. Look at this. Very important, capital remember. Main principal languages. You get a lot of tribes remember there. History. So, Northeast Frontier Agency in 1972, after that the Union Territory status, then divided 16 districts, Itanagar, Pampumpair district, Ita Fort, Kalika Purana and Mahabharata the earliest mentioned, agriculture and horticulture, Jhum cultivation practiced, festivals, so many festivals, Mopin, Solong of the Adi tribes, Losar, Boribut, Sherdukpens, Dri, Apadani tribe is here, Sidoni, Re, Idumishmis, Nyokum, Nishi. So much information. Tourist centers, Tawang, Dirang, Bumdila, Tipi, Itanagar, Malintan, Likhabali, Pasighat, Along, Tezu, Miao, Roing. These are things that you should remember. Now, don't try to by heart. This is the reason why I told you that in a single day, you should not do all. Two states per day. And two chapters per day. That is how you have to plan, by which you will be able to take it sequentially. So per day, if you are able to do two states with map. So when you are doing these states, please keep the atlas next to you. With map, if you are able to do these states, you will be able to remember. The next day, next two states and to end of the week, revise once. So revision is very, very important. Okay. So we have done three states now. Let's do another state, the last for the session. Which is Assam, a very, very important state. Okay. As we said, capital of Assam. Generally, all of us feel is Guwahati, but capital of Assam is Dispur. Okay. So, capital of Assam is Dispur. Principal language, Assamia and Bodo are two principal languages. Now, you know, Bodo is also a tribe that they live there. Bodos and Assamia is also a language. So, Assamia and Bodo are two principal languages. History and geography. Assam is situated in the northeast corner. We all know that these are part of northeast latitudes. You need not remember. For centuries, people have been living in fertile environments, very fertile region, because Assam we know is the plains of Brahmaputra. So it's a very, very fertile plain. Abundant natural resources, streams of people have met, mingled, cultures and customs have merged. Composite culture. Assam is composite culture. You'll get information about it. Bodo culture. So you'll have Assamese, you have Bodos, you have Muslims, you have Bengalis. So there is multiple cultures here. Look at what the state. The state is known as the land of Red River and Blue Hills. So which is one state of India which is known as the land of Red River and Blue Hills, Assam. It's one of the most attractive and beautiful states of the country. The mighty river Brahmaputra flows through this. Brahmaputra enters India in Arunachal Pradesh, which is Dihang. Dibang is a tributary. Dihang is where it enters. And then Brahmaputra flows through the entire Assam. So it is the lifeline. It serves as the lifeline of the people of Assam. Land of red river and blue hills, Assam. Brahmaputra is the lifeline. The word Assam is believed to be derived from the Sanskrit word. Okay, so Assam is derived from the Sanskrit word Asoma. And Asoma meaning peerless or unparalleled. The word Assam is from the Sanskrit word Asoma meaning peerless or unparalleled. Another academic interpretation that claims the word Assam came from Ahoms. So the other academic interpretation is the word came from Ahoms. So these are rulers who ruled for about 600 years prior to the annexation of British. There are two interpretations. One is the Asoma, which is a Sanskrit word. Other one is the rulers Ahoms. The influence of several races. Now Assam has several racial influences. Which are these? There are Austric races. There are Mongolians. There are Dravidians also. And there are Aryans. So, Austric, Mongolian, Dravidian, Aryan, all racial influences are intermixed here. Okay, they have contributed to the rich composite culture of Assam. So, you see the history and geography taking into consideration, northeast, fertile plains, composite culture, land of red river, blue hills, Brahmaputra, which is the lifeline. The word Assam, there are two interpretations. One is the Sanskrit word Asoma, the other one is the rulers Ahoms. Several races like the Austric, Mongolian, Dravidian, Aryan culture coming into consideration. So, it's a composite culture. Assam was known as Pragyotisha or the place of Eastern astronomy. Now, these are all potential questions. Okay. Assam was known as Pragyotisha or the place of Eastern astronomy during the epic period later named as Kamarupa. So, the Kamarupa temple specifically, all the land of Kamarupa as it's known as. Assam is known as Pragyotisha, place of Eastern astronomy during the epic period, later known as Kamarupa. Earlier epigraphic reference of the kingdom of Kamarupa is in the Allahabad pillar inscription. Allahabad pillar inscription of the king Samudragupta. Okay, so Samudragupta we know is a famous Gupta, right? He is known as the Napoleon of India. Samudragupta, and his Allahabad pillar inscription has mention of the kingdom of Kamarupa, and which is nothing but Assam, Pragyotisha. Kamarupa is mentioned as a Prayatna or frontier state outside the Gupta Empire. So it is mentioned as a frontier state, the border state of Gupta Empire. Okay, it also has mentioned in Huansang. Huansang, the Chinese pilgrim who visited Kamarupa. Right, on the invitation of the monarch Kumar Bhaskar Varman. So, Kumar Bhaskar Varman invited Huansang. So, it is mentioned in Huansang's writing also. He called the kingdom as Kamolupa. So, Kamolupa also comes in. So, you look at the amount of word Assam gets. Assam, Asoma, Ahoms the rulers, Pragyotisha, Kamarupa. Huansang mentions it as Kamolupa. Kamarupa is figured in the writings of Arabic historian Al-Biruni also. So it's not only Huansang but the Arabian. Huansang was a Chinese scholar, but the Arabian historian, which is Al-Biruni, he also mentions it. Thus, from the epic period down from the 12th century AD, Eastern Frontier Kingdom it is. That is the Pragyotisha, Eastern Frontier Kingdom or the Kamarupa. Lords of Pragyotisha, they called themselves. This is the history. So there is good amount of information. It is just a familiarity. It's not by hearting. Familiarity of this information will be able to answer so many questions. The advent of Ahoms across the eastern hills of 1228 AD was turning point of Assam history. They ruled Assam nearly for 6 centuries. The Burmese mention. Okay, so these are information, so just you should know them. The Ahom royalty that comes into picture. So Burmese invasion happened also. Burmese ceded Assam to the British by the Treaty of Yandabu. So Treaty of Yandabu has its importance in Assam's history. By the Treaty of Yandabu, Burmese ceded Assam to the British. Burmese ceded Assam to the British by the Treaty of Yandabu. Okay, so that you should know. Assam is a border state of the country also. Assam covers so much area, which is about 2.39% of the total land area of the country. International boundaries extend to Assam. So, Assam is called the gateway of northeastern states. It is surrounded by Bhutan, right? Arunachal Pradesh, Manipur, Nagaland, and Arunachal Pradesh on the east, Meghalaya, Tripura, Mizoram on south, Bangladesh. So there is Bangladesh and Bhutan that Assam surrounds. Okay. So now if you look at the geography of Assam, Assam is one northeastern state which has border with every other northeastern state. Right. Other than Sikkim, if you leave Sikkim, every other northern state, be it Arunachal Pradesh, Manipur, Nagaland, Meghalaya, Tripura, Mizoram. So every other, the six northeastern states other than Assam, everything it comes surrounding Assam. So that's how important Assam is. Mind you, if you remember the polity part, it was entirely northeastern frontier provinces and Assam. So all these Manipur, Nagaland, Meghalaya, Tripura, Mizoram, all of them have arrived out of Assam. Earlier it was entirely Assam. Okay. So what is today Assam Rifles is part of Assam because it's the British legacy. That's the geography that you should know. Let's go to the physiography of Assam. A significant geographical asset of Assam is the three of the six physiographic divisions of India, which is the Northern Himalayas, Northern Plains, and Deccan Plateau, all three come along. So Northern Himalayas, the Eastern Hills, is part of Assam. Northern Plains, which is the Brahmaputra Plains, are part of Assam. Deccan Plateau, the Karbi Anglong region, is also part of Assam and it is part of Deccan Plateau. Now, will you be able to answer a question with if it says that Assam has part of Deccan Plateau? Yes, it is. And that is the Karbi Anglong region. As Brahmaputra flows in Assam, the climate here is cold and there is widespread rainfall. Okay, so three regions, Northern Himalayas, Northern Plains and Deccan Plateau comes into the physiography. The hills of Karbi Anglong, North Kachar are in close with Guwahati, Khasi and Garo Hills, which are the Meghalaya region. Now eroded, the Barel range comes into, so in south, Barak is a river, Barak originating, the Barel range where the Assam-Nagaland border it flows through. So Barak river flows through the Assam-Nagaland border, which is the Barel ranges. And then Kachar district enters Bangladesh via the name Surma river. So the Barak river and it enters Bangladesh is known as Surma. So both are the same, but Barak enters Bangladesh with the name Surma. The almond-shaped valley aggregation of Brahmaputra and its tributaries. So please do this along with the map. Okay. Then running through the narrow passage, Meghalaya Plateau, Bhutan, Himachal, the valley finally opens into the North Bengal plains. This is the geography. The second natural division of Assam is Barak or the Surma Valley, which we have already understood. North Kachar, Manipur, Mizoram. The valley is dominated by the Barak River. Okay. Finally, it empties itself into the old bed of Brahmaputra in Bangladesh. The valley has hills or beels or lakes. Okay, so this is also part. Flood is a very common feature. Every year there are floods in Assam and Brahmaputra leads to a lot of floods in Assam. The two valleys separated by long ranges are the Karbi Hills on the NC, that is the North Kachar Hills. That's the Karbi Anglong that we call Karbi Hills in the North Kachar Hills. Okay. So these hills are erupted in plain areas, average height about 6,000 meters. Occasional peaks like, so there are six, these are peaks now. Chingison, Dumbakso. These are two peaks within Assam. So you should know them. Greenery is the hallmark of these hills, so full height of these hills in Demahaso, Hanso district. The elevation of Barel range almost 1000 to 1200 meters above sea level and the south side of Barel range is very steep. It attains a maximum height of about Mahadeo peak of the eastern half long comes around in this region. So you should know these part. So please go to the map. The map of Assam is very, very important. Mark these regions very important. You will be able to answer a lot of questions when it comes to the physiography also. Okay, these are important. Economy of the state has considerably improved. Business industry is picking up. Agriculture is abundant, fertile land because of the Brahmaputra plains. Mighty river of Brahmaputra and Barak. So Barak and Brahmaputra, two rivers that flows into. Then Barak, we also should know, is the sixth inland waterway. The latest and the sixth inland waterway on Barak River, Lakhpur to Banga, is in Assam itself, the sixth inland waterway. Okay, so 121 small and tiny tributaries that flow now. Assam has achieved 40% contribution to agriculture. State rice production has increased, likewise at other food grains production, forest and wildlife. Almost 30,000 square kilometer of forest recovers 37.33% forest cover. Okay, so very high forest cover, 37.33%. Otherwise, you need not remember these numbers. Just remember this data. The source is Forest Survey of India. Okay, so 37.33, near to 40% forest cover. 180 species of mammals are present. Which are these? These are threatened species. So these are important. Golden langur, hollow gibbon, pygmy hog. No, these are some which are not found anywhere. Golden langur, hollow gibbon, pygmy hog, hispid hare, white winged wood duck, tiger, clouded leopard, elephant, swamp deer, gangetic dolphin. These are all species which are present. These are threatened species and very important, they are present in Assam. More than 800 species of birds are also present. Tiger population has consistently increased in the state. Tiger population has risen consistently. The rhino population, now one of the very important feature of Assam is rhinos. Okay, so the one-horned rhinos are also present. Assam specifically, Manas and the Kaziranga Reserve are very important for rhino population. Okay, so you should know rhinos are very, very important, Manas and Kaziranga. Industry, when you take into, today Assam embarks a new chapter in the path of development, taking into specific, many schemes are implemented, so Assam has capital formation that it is pushed upon. Very important northeastern state. Power generation, when you take a large amount of power generation happens, largely is hydroelectric power because of the rivers and the valleys that are present. So power generation is very high. Transport and communication, when you take bridges are being constructed recently, there have been a lot of bridge, Bogbeel bridge that we saw, all these are Assam Arunachal Pradesh connection. So that is transport and communication. So no much information present here. Coming into art and culture, again, part of Northeast, so art and culture information is very high. Assam being an inseparable part. So let's look at the festivals. Being an inseparable part of the great country shares religious festivals observed elsewhere. Exclusive range of festivals specific to the cultural mosaic of the land. Bihu. Bihu is by far the most important festival of Assam. So we know Bihu is Assam. But look at here. Bihu has three different Bihus. There is one Rongali Bihu or Bohag Bihu. Then you have a Bogali Bihu or Mag Bihu, and then you have a Kangali Bihu or Kati Bihu. Bihu, we know there are three different versions of Bihu. The Rongali Bihu or Bohag Bihu is coinciding with the Assamese New Year. So Assamese New Year is the Rongali Bihu or the Bohag Bihu. The harvest festival is known as the Bogali Bihu or Mag Bihu. What you celebrate as Sankranti is their Bogali Bihu or Mang Bihu, which is their harvest festival. And then the third Bihu is the Kangali Bihu or Kati Bihu, which is observed to pray of love and yearning. So there are three different Bihus: Rongali, which is New Year, Bogali or Mang Bihu, which is the harvest festival, Kangali Bihu or Kati Bihu is observed for the prayer of love or yearning. So this is important. Apart from this, Bodos, the largest tribal group, they perform the Kerai Puja. So who perform the Kerai Puja? In Assam, Kerai Puja is celebrated. Bodos and the tribal group celebrate the Kerai Puja as a festival. Kerai Puja is accompanied by shamanistic dance performed by female artists. So shamanistic dance is performed by female artists. Right, who get to the trance, vigorous movements of head, tossing, swinging, disheveled hair. Bato is another important puja. So, Kerai Puja and Bato is another important puja of the Bodos. So, this is a rich culture of Assam that you should note. Tourism, Assam is considered the gateway of Northeast, has emerged as a popular destination. Unique flora, fauna, biodiversity, virgin forest, proud hills are present. Assam is a major hub of wildlife. You know, Assam has very rich ecotourism. This is spelling mistake here. This is ecotourism. H is wrong. Ecotourism. 79.5 meter above the sea level, 5 national parks. Okay, that's 5 national parks, 19 wildlife sanctuaries, 3 bird sanctuaries. Very rich. Okay, so 5 national parks, 19 wildlife sanctuaries and 3 bird sanctuaries. Please mark them on the map. You will be getting one or the other. Most important one is Manas, Kaziranga, and you will find many others. Important places for tourism is the Kamakhya Devi temple. Now, Kamakhya temple is one very important temple. Kamakhya temple is in Assam. Other than that is the Unmanda Island. There's a peacock island. It's also known as the Unmanda Temple. This is also in Assam. Navagraha Temple is also in Assam. So Kamakhya Temple, Unmanda Temple, also known as the Peacock Island. Where is Peacock Island? Assam. Navagraha Temple of 9 planets. Vasishta Ashram. Vasishta is Vasishta, which is also going back to the Hindu culture. The Vasishta Ashram. Dol Govinda Temple. State Zoo, State Museum. Madan Kamdev Temple. So Madan Kamdev Temple is also part of Assam. Saraighat Bridge, Sri Mata Sankardev. So Sri Mata Sankardev Kalakshetra. Sankaradeva Kalakshetra. Okay. Mind you, when you take into the different classical dances that we take, Assam has two important classical dances that comes into, of which the Sankarya dance is also one. So Sankaradeva Kalakshetra comes in Kaziranga National Park. As I've already mentioned. Okay, so these are some of the tourism centers. This is where you largely come to the close. Finally, government, governor, chief minister, chief secretary, locate in the jurisdiction of High Court. Now, jurisdiction of Assam High Court is not only to Assam, but also to Nagaland, to Mizoram and Arunachal Pradesh. So, Arunachal Pradesh, Mizoram, Nagaland, all of them are served by the Assam High Court, which is in Guwahati. Okay, so this is Assam, a very, very important state. Okay, so very quick understanding of what we did in Assam. Assam being having a very rich history, we understood the history of Assam, where we saw what is the specific idea as such in terms of northeast corner, fertile, right, land of Red River, Blue Hills, all the history of it in terms of the composite culture, different names, Hohensang to Arabian historian Alberoni, Kamarupa to Kamalupa, Prajyotisha, all the names that it is called, Treaty of Yandabu, where the Burmese ceded Assam back to British, and how it is surrounded by Bhutan and Bangladesh, all the northeastern states that are surrounded. Physiography, you have Northern Himalayas, Northern Plains and Deccan Plateau. Deccan Plateau, remember, is also there, Assam. Barak River and the Brahmaputra rivers, two important rivers, take into consideration. The hills that are around, Mahanjo Peak comes into specification. Agriculture, very rich forest and wildlife, the specific species that are present here, rhino population, industry, power plants, largely hydroelectric power plants, festivals, three different Bihus, Rongali Bihu or Bohag, Bogali Bihu or Mag Bihu, Kungali Bihu or Kati Bihu, Bodo celebrating Kirai Puja and the Bato Puja, and the tourism, we have seen multiple temples. So this is how important is Assam. Okay, so friends, this was an idea of giving you how important it is to do states and union territories. Okay, so let me repeat once again, kindly do states and union territories, but don't do them all together. Two states in a day and two chapters. So reserve about 1.5 to 2 hours per day specifically for the yearbook. It is very important use of time, a very good revision of all what you have studied. Current affairs question can be applied, which can come from here. Two chapters, if they are small chapters, and two states. Or a single chapter, if there is a large chapter, and two states. Whenever you are doing states, please keep the atlas next to you and do the mapping of that particular state along. Don't do it randomly. Generally pick up state. Like we picked up Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, very close by states. Similarly, we picked up Assam and Arunachal Pradesh. So, you can do, say for example, Jammu and Kashmir as one state and then Himachal and Uttarakhand as two states. Okay? then you can do Haryana in Punjab together. Why? Geographically, you will be able to understand them very well, and information you will be able to gather them very well. Okay. When you go for any state and the start of the state, you will have the important information in terms of this information. So please do this information when you start a state, the capital, principal language. At the end, the jurisdiction of the high court of that state, and then the history, geography, and all other what we have done here. This is very, very important. Kindly do them. I hope all of you are taking maximum use. We have seen the lockdown has been extended for another 14 days. Please make very good use of this time. The exam is definitely going to be postponed. UPSC should be announcing the new dates within the next week. Let's wait for that. But by yourself, keep studying. Take great care of yourself. Take great care of your health. Keep studying. Stay cheered. Always get back for any clarification or doubts. Thank you so much. Hope to see you soon. Stay safe. Stay home.